Sometimes we forget that we don't have the congregation, so we wait for the congregation to shout amen. Only afterwards do you realize that the congregation you have is online. And for our online congregation this afternoon, welcome so much. Thanks for being with us this afternoon. And for the minutes that the Lord will give unto us, we know we will have a beautiful time in His presence. We appreciate so much your company. We appreciate so much that you honor us with your resources, your bundles, and your time. And you keep coming and you keep, you know, tuning in. And we thank God for those of us who share out these broadcasts out. We thank God for those who tag people into this broadcast. It is such an honor for us, and we always feel so honored and so valued. We always feel so needed and so appreciated. There is no human being on earth that does not thrive by appreciation. Every one of us want to be appreciated, how we look, how we do things. You know, when we give people, we want to be appreciated. We want to be acknowledged. At times, we want to be mentioned. Whatever we do, we want it to be, you know, be trumpeted to other people and other forums. Even as right now, we are not so so different. It feels so good when you can share out the broadcast within the groups that you're in. We always feel so good. Just a disclaimer, we don't do this for the likes, we don't do this for the views, we don't do this for the comments, no. We do this for His glory. We do this for His glory, but He, the one has told us how beautiful all the mountains are at the feet. They who spread good news. So when you're sharing out, you know, this broadcast, you're fulfilling scripture, and you become entitled to the blessings that has spoken about us. He says that we shall be His witnesses, you know, from Jerusalem all the way to Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. So the teachings, not just what we are preaching, even what other men of God are preaching, because we are all part of one large, big family. As we share our broadcast, you know, you become part of they that are, you know, we call them heralds. You know, they publish, you know, they publish the word. You know, the Bible will tell us in Psalms that God spoke the word, and great was the company of they that published. You know, they that, you know, gave the word the voice, gave the word the things, you know, and you know, they that just made the word to, you know, move to the uttermost parts of the earth. So you become part of that group. God has given His word. Ones who publish the word, we are called great. Is the company of those. I know there's a version that says that great is the company of the women, you know, who publish the word. So we become part of that great company that publishes the word. And I think I've become a lawyer to my own self. By now, you're convinced that if you share the broadcast or tag some people along or into the broadcast, and we hear what the Lord has in store for us today. And it's a beautiful week. It's a beautiful week. Almost the last week of this month. The last week of this month. Today is Tuesday. And we have another broadcast in the evening. We have the Tuesday arrived broadcast in the evening from around 8 p.m. So we see you again at 8 p.m. But before we see you again at 8 p.m., allow us to just look at Hebrews chapter number 2 from verse number 6 to verse number 9. I'm interested only in verse number 9. But just allow us to read through so at least we can you know, the width and the length, the height and the depth of this word. And we are trusting that you have a good start to the week. Yesterday we were teaching on power, or the need the body of Christ to be carriers of power. So this afternoon, so briefly, I just want to teach so briefly on, but we see Jesus. One of the things that is making me happy, I think as I travel through various, you know, from various men of God and women of God, is to see the return and the restoration of Christ into His body. It is so fascinating. It is so entertaining. Not entertaining in a worldly way, but entertaining in a spiritual way. You know, to see how many people are preaching on salvation, see how many people are preaching on the cross, see how many people are preaching and teaching on Christ. You know, it's such a revival, such an awakening. It's such a good thing, because at the end of everything matters. It is not the cars, it is not the houses, it is not the travel, it is not the money, it is not our connections, it is not the visas, it is not how many times my passport has been stamped. It is not how many, it is not even the what, it is the who. The Lord Jesus Christ. That's all there is to in life. And every other thing, you know, seek ye first the kingdom and righteousness, and then the rest shall be added. The rest are additions, and whatever can be added can be deducted. Whatever is an addition at the point of death becomes a subtraction in our lives, becomes something that will be minus from our lives. We will not go to the other side of life with the vehicles, we will not go to the other side of life, you know, with the houses, with the clothes, with fashion, with anything. So whatever is an addition because you don't need it eventually. It will help you in the short while, it will help you in this life, you know, as we journey through life. But when we come to the last and to the end of our life, whatever was an addition will remain. But whatever is the major thing, the kingdom and its righteousness, that's all that will remain. Every other thing will shed off. Every other thing. You know, if you forget, I think it's 2 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse number 1. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle are dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. In this house, the body that we are in right now, we groan. But honestly, we keep desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, no, but clothed upon that mortality might be swallowed up by immortality. Or must be swallowed up by life. While we are on or in this earthly tabernacle, we know that at some point the Bible uses two words: it shall be dissolved, and we shall shed it off. It shall be dissolved. The money will be dissolved. You know, the class, the social status will be dissolved. The businesses will be dissolved. The wealth, the riches will be dissolved. One thing will remain: that which is of the heavenly kingdom. That is why Jesus never made a mistake. Matthew 6, 33, 12, 31 of Luke. He never made a mistake. The seek ye first. In other words, prioritize the kingdom. Why? The kingdom is the only one that has eternity riding in it and on it. So as we achieve the kingdom, we have achieved every other thing there is to achieve in life. So I pray for us that, I don't know where this has started from, but I pray for us that we will prioritize the kingdom above every other thing. Every other thing has its end, it will dissolve. But that which is of the kingdom will remain even unto the eternities of time. Now, but we see Jesus, Hebrews chapter number 2, verse number 6. But one in a certain place, now you don't have to swear, it's Psalms chapter number 8, from verse number 3 to verse number 6. But one in a certain place, testified saying, what is man? So I'm reading Psalms 8 now, verse number 3 in Hebrews 2, verse number 6. But what is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you visit him? And you have made him a little lower than the angels. And you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have set him over the works of thy hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all things in subjection under him. Now, allow me to first of all interpret, you know, verse number 6, 7, and 8. Because verse number 8 and 9 are brothers and sisters. So let me interpret 6 and 7. Then 8 and 9 are interpreted together. Now, I want you to see six things that the Father has done. You know, I remember there's a time we've done a teaching. I think it's last week. We did a teaching on why you cannot fail as a believer. Maybe 3 weeks ago, why you cannot fail as a believer. Now, I want you to write these six things, or if you have, you know, a memory that is computerized, it can just record this, it is okay. The Lord bless you. Some of us have to write somewhere. We have to, underline our Bibles and keep on writing inside. It has become whatever. Now, I want you to see these six things, and I will say them so quickly because this is not what I needed to teach this afternoon. I just need to say something in verse number 9, the A part of it, but we see Jesus just now. But we see Jesus now. There are six things that we need to see here. The one, that God is mindful of you. God is mindful of you. Regardless of how bad the situation is right now, regardless of how far back, regardless of how, you know, left you are, regardless of how forgotten you may be in the spheres of life, one, I want you to understand that God is mindful of you. He has not forgotten you. He has not forsaken you. You know, it was amazing for the writer of Psalms chapter number 8 to say, but what is man You know, he says that when I consider the heavens and the works of your hands, as in when he considered the entirety of God's creation, the oceans, the mountains, and now whatever else, you know, that you can look at and you see how amazing it is. He says, what is man that you're mindful of him? What is man? No, this song,
if you put on your mics, is Bwana Mungu na shagaa kabisa. If you can just sing that one stanza and then the chorus, because Alfie is here and he's playing the keyboard. At least that people will know that we don't do recorded music. So for us, we don't need to sing right now. Please allow me to say this so quickly.
I have really been disturbed when we sing songs done by Kenyan artists. And any other artists, we have to write on our Facebook pages that we don't own the rights to that song. And I keep asking myself, if we, the body of Christ, we don't own the rights to sing your song without making a disclaimer, what about heaven? I know you bring in the aspect of the music industry and they're the ones who sang the song, but if God gave you that song, that's what should bless the body. And I want to believe that is why most of our songs don't even have any impact in them. You know, raise a conflict if you may. Why do I have to sing a song? I have even seen some of my friends even now, you know, even Apostle Mika says, he's just a simple in worship, but he has to say, we don't own the rights as far as this song is concerned. If you sing a song, why can't it bless the body of Christ? I know that there are the royalties and the rights, you know, that will come from the Music Society of Kenya and Skiza Tunes and all that. But thank God for some songs that were sung by some people. And we don't have to write that we don't own the rights, because those songs were sung as a blessing to the body of Christ. Nimemaliza siasa. Bwana Mungu na shanga kabi. Nikifikiri jinsi ulivyo, nyota ngurumo, yote pia viumbavyo kwa uwezo wako. The heavens and the works of your hands. Now he starts saying these things. What is man? So number one, please let me say this in advance. Then, but we see Jesus. We will see him on Wednesday tomorrow. Let's list these things. And now we're not preaching the gospel and teaching it to finish. we are just preaching it very far, and I know in my Noah I'll not be able to go to verse number 8 and verse number 9, and it is not a crime. It is not a crime. Even Jesus, he told them in John chapter number 14, 15 and 16, about this teaching of the Holy Spirit, tells them that I have so much to tell you, but you cannot capture it right now. You cannot receive it right now. He says, but when the Holy Spirit will come, John 16, when the Holy Spirit will come, he will remind you of all the things, you know, that I have been saying, and he will take of what is mine and release it unto you. So I have a lot to say to you today, but when Wednesday comes, we will do it. We will do it from Wednesday. So allow me to just do verse number 6 and verse number 7 and verse number 8, part 1, you know, the A part of it. So number 1, six things that are so amazing. As far as God and man is concerned, six things that are so amazing. The first one is that God is mindful of man. God is so mindful of man. You know, I will read this from Genesis chapter number 6. And you read from, you know, the beginning part of it all the way. By the time you're coming to verse number 5 and verse number 6 of Genesis chapter number 6, the Bible says, and God regretted that he had created man. Kwa Mungu alianza kutokeshwa na mwanadamu kuanzia Genesis chapter number 6. But notice, from Genesis chapter number 6 to where we are right now is more than 6,000 years. It's 6,000 years and counting. But until now, God still is mindful of man. I want to say this. God maybe has seen the worst of man, and maybe he is seeing the worst of man right now. And I want to say sorry to him, because he has not seen the last of man, because he says himself in Genesis 6 and verse number 5 that the mind of man thinketh evil continually. And you realize this, because by the time you're coming to, you know, Genesis chapter number 19, God is finishing a man. No, actually, after, by the time we're in chapter number 7 of the book of Genesis, he's brought the flood waters, and he clears everyone apart from 8 people. That is Noah and his sons. He clears everyone, and we only have Noah and his sons. You know, Noah and his sons and their wives and so on and so forth, only 8 people remain out of the whole, you know, genealogy that we are given in Genesis chapter number 5. And this one begot, and this one begot, and this one begot. Out of all those who begot, of them that remains in Genesis chapter number 7. Now, in chapter number 19, he's now finishing people with fire. The first one was the flood, the water. The second one is fire. And he says, never again will I finish people, or will I, you know, wipe out a whole generation with fire. By the time we come to the book of Exodus, if you keep reading chapter number 32, you realize that God is having a conversation with Moses. And God tells Moses and Aaron, because people have fashioned a calf. Worshipping this golden calf, you know, at the foot of Mount Sinai, or whatever names you can call it. Now they are worshipping a golden calf. Comes, you know, Moses is having a conversation with God, and God tells him, go down, because the people you brought from Egypt, they have turned back so quickly, and they have fashioned for themselves an idol calf, and they are worshiping that idol calf. And Moses goes down, and Moses is also so mad, you know, but God also tells Moses, you and Aaron, please, just aside. I will finish all this, the fathers, the mothers, the children, I will clear all of them, and I will create for you another breed of people. God is, you know, intentional on wiping people. And on and on and on. You realize now, by the time we come to Numbers 13, you know, Numbers 13, when they send the spies, you know, to Canaan, and they come back, and 10 of them give, you know, a disheartening report. Only Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, you know, they give, you know, a positive report. By the time we come to Numbers 14, he is finishing people again. I believe in Numbers 14, he kills 21,000 of them. We keep walking. By the time you're looking at Nadab and Abihu again, and that is why, you know, the Muslim will tell you that our Christian God is a killing God. And I will not be a lawyer for him on that. I will not be a lawyer on him for that, but he has seen the best and the worst of humanity. The best and the worst for as far as humanity is concerned. You know, he's so concerned about us that he even allows the death of his own son. so mindful of us. I've given you that short history to show you that God has seen us as far as humans are concerned. God has been subjected to the best, the ugly, and the beautiful. He says that what is man that you're mindful of him. I want to say this to any one of us right here that will be, you may be condemning yourself, he's mindful of you. Any one of us that will be feeling, I'm so far away that his heart cannot find me, it cannot reach me. He's still mindful of you. Any one of us who may be feeling that my better days are in my yesterday, I want to say this with all due confidence. He is still mindful of you. God is in the yesteryears. You know how he moved with you, how he walked with you, how he provided for you, how he connected you with people and connected you with possessions, and you feel like your best is in your yesterday. Even today, he is mindful of you. Bible will tell us in Lamentations, one of the books that was written by Jeremiah, was of his compassion. They are new every morning, and great is the faithfulness of God. The Lord is my portion, so my soul says, I will hope. And so on and so forth. So hear me, child of God. The Lord is mindful about you. It doesn't matter how far back you've walked. You know, Luke chapter number 15. The Father says this. This, my son, that was lost, is now back home. He still calls the boy, or he still calls this young man, my son. So he is mindful. He is mindful of you. The second thing, or the son of man, that thou visitest him. Now, I want to say this, whether we know it or not, whether we appreciate it or not, Jehovah hath never missed a visiting day. Those of us who've gone through the 844 system, we know that during the visiting day, you know, our eyes will forever be on Jesus, but we see Jesus. Our eyes will forever be on the school gate. Regardless how small or big it was, whether it was green or yellow or magenta, you will, as we will stand at the parade ground, because from the parade ground you will see the gate. And I believe most of the schools you will see the gate from the parade ground, because like-minded people, Africans now, you will keep your eyes focused on the gate. You wouldn't even go to the toilet just in case your mom or your dad or whoever was your dad would come. Now, in Genesis chapter number 3, let me just prove this to myself. Genesis chapter number 3, that God has never missed a visiting day. Now, verse number 8, the Bible will tell us that, and they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Now, from where I sit, I know that God is all-knowing. He is omniscient. He is all. So when Adam and Eve sinned against him, I want you to know, or I want to remind you, because I know you know, he knew that they had disobeyed him, but he still came. He still came. I know we will disqualify ourselves based on so many other situations, but even though God knew that Adam and Eve had partaken of the fruit from the tree he told them not to, he still came and he still called out for them. Why? What is man that you're mindful of him and you visit him? I want to say this. There isn't anything in the entire life that can stop God from coming to you when he is intentional. I prove again to myself, Acts chapter number 7, verse number 52, 54. I need to be faster than this. I said 6. I mean number 2. Now, chapter number 7. And they cast him out of the city. This is Stephen. They have killed. They stoned him. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses lay down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. Now, chapter number 8 is about Philip. Chapter verse number 9. Now, verse number 1. Saul was still breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. And he went unto the high priest and he desired from him that he will get letters. You know, that he will get letters. And he gets the letters. Now, verse number 3. And he journeyed. And he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell on the earth, and he heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And Paul says, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus. This Jesus visited a murderer. Not a manslaughter guy, no, a murderer guy in the name of Saul, who had papers and letters authorizing him to go and kill the believers and just scatter them. And that's what you see in chapter number 8, the first verse will say that after the death of Stephen, great persecution arose and they were scattered. Verse number 4, they were preaching the gospel. Who scattered them? The presence of Saul. But even they saw Jesus visited. Now I want to say this with all due biblical reference and respect. There is nothing in your life that will stop God to visit you when he is in need of you. He visited Adam after they had disobeyed. He visited Saul even after he's the one who sanctioned the death and the stoning of Stephen. And he went ahead even to get letters for the legality of killing the believers. Now, I've said so many things to say this, that God is mindful of you too. God will visit you. In whatever situation, God will visit you. Even the Lord Jesus Christ is saying, it is not the whole that are in need of a doctor, it is the sick. And he tells the woman in Matthew chapter number 15, the Samaritan woman, the woman, you know, the Syrophoenician woman that had a daughter that was dying, he told her that I cannot take the bread of the children, the bread of the children, and give it to the dogs. And he said, for this reason I was sent only to the house of Israel. He came to them not because they were right. He came to them because they were lost. That's what he says in Luke 19 and verse number 10. He says that I came to seek and save the lost. I want to say this. None of us is so lost that God has written your eulogy and he has signed off that you are broken beyond repair. He will visit you. He will visit you. You may have been anything, you know, a worship leader, a preacher, a businessman in the church, and you went back so far back. But I want to say this, what is man that thou visitest him? He will visit you. Preachers can write you off, believers can write you off, you know, fellow team members can write you off, but I have this assurance in me that God has never written any one of us off. All I know is, he sits like the Father in Luke chapter number 15. The Bible tells us that he always sat facing the gates to his compound. He knew and he hoped that one day this son will come back home. That is why the Bible says, there's a song sung by a group, I can't remember their name, I think it's Mercy Me, and the title of the song is When God Ran. No, it is not Mercy Me has done, but there's also Craig, Philip and Craig and Dean. They did this song in the 90s. The title of the song is When God Ran. It is the only time in the Bible we see an old man running. He sat outside his house and his eyes were always fixed to the gate. He knew, or he desired, he hoped that one day this son we call the prodigal son will come back home. And the prodigal son came back home. I believe with all my heart that our Father sits with open arms, that one day we will come back home. Why? He will always visit his sons. The third one. Verse number 7. The first one is that God is mindful of you. Two, that God visits. It is in present continuous. He visits. He visits man. Three, that he has made him, God, made man a little lower than the angels. And he made man a little lower than the angels. I want to say this. If God would make man, not even if seeing that our Father made us a little lower than the angels, he can make you a multi-millionaire. He can make you a mother. He can make you to have peace. He can make you to have a job. There is nothing in the entire universe he cannot make you. If he could make dust, man that is formed from dust, a little lower than the angels, I want to say this hour, there is nothing he cannot make you. He He can make you a boss. He can make you, you know, a businessman, a businesswoman. He can make you, you know, a politician that has sanity and the spirit of God. The other one, forget. He can make you. And I want to believe with, you know, with all my heart, as Jeremiah chapter number 18 will tell us, that if we would understand that we are the clay and stop arguing, stop fighting with the potter, he can make you into anything he so desires. He can make you into anything he so desires. And right now your life may look like a construction site. A wheelbarrow there, you know, kokoto pale, kijiko ya koroga hapa, gumboots pale, apron pale, you know, mchanga pale. Your life may look just so disjointed and scattered. But hear me, child of God, what is man? You maketh him. He can join up the pieces. Ezekiel 37, son of man, his bones live. And he says, son of man, prophesy unto them. And I want to say this so quickly. There is nothing in the entire of your dreams. There is nothing in the entire of your desires that God cannot make you. If you will present yourself and utulie kama finyanza, anaweza kukufinyanga, ukawa kile anachokipenda yeye, that he can make something good out of nothing. When they come to Nathaniel in the book of John, they come to Nathaniel, they tell him, we've seen, Philip tells him, we've met the Messiah. Nathaniel is like, can anything good come out of Nazareth? But the entire history of Christianity springs from a very backward village called Nazareth. The first time you hear it and the last time you hear it is as far as Christ is concerned. What else do you know about Nazareth apart from Christ? And he gave publicity to a very mediocre village called Nazareth. He can make you to anything he so desires. This God, despite our failings, despite our backwardness, despite our everything, he can make you. He can make you to become anything that he wants you to become. But you got to tell him, Father, you know, nifinyange niwe kama upendavyo, as he made me to be that which you want me to be. Stop fighting. Some of us, we know that the calling of God is on our life, but we still pursue nothing. You will pursue nothing until you pursue nothing and nothing will come out of it. But allow him to make you into, and he makes. Number four, that thou crowns him with glory and honor. That God, anyone that is being crowned, is anyone that has gone through a period of testing, has gone through a period of hardship, has gone through a period of, you know, of persecution, a period of tribulation, and now, you know, and pain. But the Bible says that thou crowns him with glory and with honor. You have never seen any man being crowned before they completed or before they came to the end of whatever was a tough time. Now the Bible says this, that God crowns man with glory and with honor. And we speak that into your life, into the level of your hands, that you be crowned with glory and also be crowned with honor. That the hierarchy of your life is glory. That the hierarchy, everything about your life, from, you know, bottom to top, everything about your life, as in the underscore of your life, that whatever you're doing with your life, glory will be reflected. That whatever you do with your life, honor will be reflected. That what is man, that you crown him with glory. And child of God, from wherever you're watching us from, I speak that in your life, that receive the crowning of glory and the crowning of honor. This tells me, when I'm crowned with glory, I cannot undergo shame. I cannot suffer shame. Shame is not my portion. When I'm crowned with honor, I'm accepted. I'm accepted. I'm presentable. Not because of my grades, not because of my skin color, not because of my tribe, not because of how well I speak the language, no. But because I'm crowned with something supernatural, the glory and the honor that God releases on man. Now this, and I understand, you know, when the Bible tells us in 1 Samuel chapter number 2, it is also repeated in the Song of Mary, know that God lifts the needy, the downcast from the ashes. and he seats them with the princes of his people. How? He crowns them. They were not of royal birth, no. But God crowns the life of David with glory and honor. That even right now, Jesus, we call him the son of David. God is mindful. God will visit you. That God will make you. God will crown you. Number five. He says, and you have set him over the works of thy heart. Or you have given him dominion over the works of your heart. Allow me to use the Mfalme Yakobo version, the King Jimmy version, and use the word set him. Set him. That God will set you over. He will give you dominion. He will set you over. He will give you dominion. That whatever you're doing in life, you're not doing it like someone that is preparing for someone else to come and finish. No. You're doing it as the final person. You're doing it as the man. That in your life, you're not living a second tier life. No. You're living a first class life. Why? You've been set over the works of God's hand. That God has given us dominion over his works. So you have dominion over creation. You have dominion over the weather. You have dominion over the atmosphere. You have dominion over everything that God has created. God created managers. He created stewards. And you're one of the stewards that he created. Bible will tell us, I believe, 1 Corinthians 4, verse number 1, 2, verse number 2, 1 Corinthians 4, 2, that it is required, it is expected of stewards that they may be found faithful. Faithful to what? Faithful to that which, the blueprint of our employer, of our creator. That what is man, that you have made him a steward over everything that God created. Now, to verse number 7 and 8, that silver and gold belongs to God. So this tells me, I'm a steward of gold. I'm a steward of silver. I'm a steward of diamonds. I'm a steward of his wealth. I'm a steward of the kingdom. He has given us the kingdom. He has released the kingdom into us. Luke 17 and verse 15. That the kingdom is in us. So he has even given us the kingdom. I should believe it should be Luke chapter number 6. Or Matthew chapter number 6 verse number 32. Final word, Steve. Matthew chapter number 6 verse number 32. The Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. If he has given us the kingdom, allow me to correct myself. Seeing that he has given us the kingdom, two, seeing that he has given us his son, what else? Actually, with the kingdom and the son, what are we missing? What has not been committed into our hands? So he has set us over the works of his works, or of his work. The works, you know, set us over the works of his hands. Poverty is not a curse, it's a choice. I'll say that again. It is not a curse, it's a choice. You will know the truth, I will know the truth, and will set me free. That I'm not just here as a hustler, no. I'm not just here as someone who goes up and down, no. I'm not here as someone who is seeking for things that he will never find, no. When I ask, he answers. When I seek, I find. When I knock, he opens. So I have been given dominion over the works of God's hand. So I will say this with all due respect. Money is a servant to any person that understands who they are in Christ, in God. And let me make this understandable. When I speak about money, it doesn't mean that you have the means. No, it means that you have what you want. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. All I have needed. Jesus told the disciples when he's sending them out in Matthew chapter number 10, that as you go, don't buy anything. Why? Whatever they needed was to be provided as they went. All I ask is not to have billions of money in my account. In my account. For what for? All I ask is, what is it I want in my life right now? Father, supply unto my needs according to your riches in glory. Please understand, he is supplying. He is not, you know, he's not just offloading. He is supplying. A supplier is a supplier because he keeps on bringing. He keeps on bringing. So it is not a one-off. He will keep on supplying at your need according to his riches in glory. The last one, he says that he has put all things in subjection under the that he has all things. He is mindful of you. He visits you. He makes you. He crowns you. He has set you over and seeks. He has put all things under the subjection of a man. I want to say this. Everything that is under the heavens, he has put it under our subjection, under our command. One of the verses I have read a million times, and I make no apologies, is Psalm 115, verse number 16. And I also saw that verse in the book of Deuteronomy. And it says this, that the heavens and the highest of heavens belongs to God, but the earth he has given to the sons of men. And you are one of them. So hear me, child of God, that he has put everything under the subjection of a man. This tells me, whatever you can call, Genesis 2:19, whatever Adam called any of the animals, it became. So whatever you call it, it shall become. But it will not become if you don't have the understanding. Because without the understanding, you cannot marshal faith. You cannot exercise faith in ignorance. It is impossible. You have to know. After you know, then you can exercise faith. That's why Jesus will keep telling them, these things I have told you when I am yet with you. Otherwise, he will ask them, have you not understood? Have you not known? For how long will I continue being with you? And then he will call them a faithless generation. Why? There are things and lessons they were supposed to learn from me, but they were not quick to learn them. And infuriated Christ because he wanted them to catch it. And if you keep reading, by the time you come to John chapter number 16, they tell him, now we understand what you're saying because you're saying things plainly. And he rejoices that now they have understood. And you keep reading, the Bible says that far, we rejoice. Matthew 11, verse number 26, we rejoice. These things, verse number 25, that you have shut these things, you know, from they that, you know, that the thing that they know, and you have revealed them unto children. And that was his desire, that we as the children of God, the sons of God, would understand that he is mindful of us. We will understand that he crowns us. We will understand that he makes us. That we would know that he has, you know, that he has put us, he has set us over. He has set us over. We also know that he has put all things under the subjection of our feet. So hear me, child of God, you can command riches and they will be. You can command wealth, it will be. You can command connections, they will be. Command health, it will be. You can command long life, it will be. Why? It is under our feet. I believe it's Romans 15, verse number 20. It says that it says that God will crush the enemy under our feet. Why? Even the devil, he has been put under our command. That is why the Bible says you shall cast demons out. Why? You cannot command that which surpasses you in authority, that which surpasses you in knowledge, that which surpasses you in hierarchy. So six things that we have said this afternoon, and they are yours. They are yours. That is how God sees you. He is mindful of you. He is mindful of you. He visits you. He makes you. He crowns you. Then he sets you over. Then he puts everything under your feet. Into under the subjection of your feet. So I want you to understand right now, you're the master. You're the boss. You're the man. You're the one in control. You shall know the truth. And the truth that you know, it shall set you free. I pray for you this afternoon that you will appropriate God's word for your life and into your life. That is who you are, and that is how God sees you. God is not seeing, you know, a single mother that is struggling, you know, to be loved, that is struggling to reestablish a connection with the ex, you know, with the ex-boyfriend or whatever. He sees you as someone that he has set over. He is not seeing you as a 16-year-old. No, he's not seeing you even as an old person. No, he sees you as someone under whom everything bows. All things are put under the subjection of your feet. And once you understand that, now we start living a better life. Why? We know the truth, and the truth sets us free. Father, we pray this afternoon in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that your word would have a place in our hearts. We pray that we will not continue on being taught and learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. But the far we can be taught, we can study the word, and the Lord, we appropriate you, and we become that which you created us to become. Father, we repent for the many times we have lived below the standard of what you created us to become, and we have believed in a lie that you are unable to make us become who you have created us to become. But right now, oh God, we pray, let knowledge come into us, let the understanding of your word come into our lives. And Father, we pray even more, teach us to practice the word. Teach us to do the word, because we know that you're watching over your word as we do, given us dominion. And the Lord, you have established us as masters, that you have put things under the subjection of our feet. We pray, the Lord, it will not only be something, a good teaching we have heard, but it will become the testimony of our lives. That the Lord has been mindful of me, that the Lord has been visiting me, that the Lord has crowned my life, that the Lord has made me to be what I am right now, that the Lord has set me over, and that everything is under my feet. This we proclaim in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Speak a blessing into your life this afternoon. We'll see you again in the evening. Shalom, and have a lovely afternoon. In Jesus' name. Amen.